Hey everyone, it's Chris. Welcome back to another part of our Mario Clone tutorial series. And in this tutorial, we are going to continue on with our question blocks. So in the last tutorial, we've added the ability for them to bounce up and down, okay? So the next thing we're gonna need to do is we need to show that these blocks have been bounced and now they are basically empty and they can't be used anymore. So what we need to do is we need to add some code that basically will stop the animation that's currently happening, because if we're going to change the sprite of our block, we can't have an animation running, because what it'll happen is the animation will overwrite the sprite that we've set with the next animation in the frame of the animation that's set up, so that we'll never even see the change. It'll just keep running its animation. So first, we need to get rid of the animation, and then we need to change the actual sprite graphic. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started on that, and we are going to open up the question block script. And, okay, so first thing we need to do is we need to actually have a reference to the sprite that we want to replace our current sprite with. So we're going to create a public sprite type, and we're going to name this empty block sprite. Okay. Now we'll have to assign that in the inspector, but we can go ahead and use the variable for now. And what we'll do here is we're going to create a method, and we'll simply name this change sprite. Okay. And all we gotta do to do this is call get component, and we're gonna grab the animator, and we're gonna set the enable property of the animator to false. Okay, so we're gonna disable animation, and then we're gonna get component, and we're going to get the sprite renderer component, and we're going to set its sprite property to equal the empty block sprite. Okay, so that's going to do that. And we're going to call the change sprite method from within our bounce coroutine when that first is called. So here we're going to change sprite. Okay, so the player bounces strikes the block, which then causes the block to bounce. Okay, and the first thing it does is it changes the sprite. It runs through these two while loops, and then okay. So the first thing that the coroutine is going to do is it's going to run this method here, change sprite, and then it's going to run through its while loops to do the bounce. Okay, so let's go ahead and have a look and see if that works. But first, remember, we have to set our sprite. So in our prefabs, click on our block, scroll down, see how we don't have a sprite defined here, an empty block sprite. So we'll go to our graphics, and the empty block sprite is right here, this one. Okay, so we'll just drag that in here, right? And let's click on our question mark blocks in the scene, make sure they've been updated. Okay, and then they look fine. All right, so let's go ahead and click play and see what happens. Call the enemy. Oh, now it's empty. There we go. All empty, okay. Now what we want to do is we want to get something in return for all this hard work, right? So for striking a block with our head, we should get a coin at the very least. So let's implement that. All we got to do is, I've already created a if you look in here in the prefabs, I've created a spinning coin, and that's one of the reasons that we put all these in the resources folder, is so that we can instantiate these at runtime, which this spinning coin is going to need to be instantiated at runtime. So, because what's going to happen is We're not going to go ahead and drag these into the scene, although we could. We could say there's Z indexes to be behind the blocks. But I think that's honestly just too much work. So to instantiate it in the code is going to be a lot faster. Okay, so what we need to do is we need to instantiate this coin right at or above the block that is going to be struck. And we're going to instantiate it. We're going to send it flying upwards and let it come back down and then make it disappear. Okay? So we're going to use coroutines for that, just like we did for the block bouncing. And let's go ahead and get into that. So I'll open the question block script once more. And the a couple things we're going to need are some more variables. I love variables. Public, float. We need a coin move speed, because how fast is the coin going to actually go up and down? So coin move speed, we're going to set that equal to 8. Public, float, coin move height. And this is how high we actually want the coin to go from its current position, where it's being instantiated. And then public, float, coin fall distance, how far we want it to fall before it is destroyed. Okay. And that's it for the variables. So the next thing we're going to do is we are going to create a coroutine, and we're going to name this, let's create it directly below bounce coroutine. So IEnumerator. We're going to call this move coin, and we're going to pass it a game object, and the game object is going to be the coin that we want to move. Okay. And we're also going to create a method that is going to start this move coin process, and that method is going to be called present coin. Okay. And the present coin method the present coin method is actually going to instantiate our coin prefab, and it's going to then do some it's going to update its position, tell it where to spawn, and then start the coroutine. So let's go ahead and start writing that code. Game object, okay, spinning coin. And we're going to cast game object to instantiate. And then we're going to use resources.load to load from the resources folder. We're going to load from the prefabs folder. And we are loading spinning coin. And the resources.load method wants to know what type of prefab are we loading, and our type of prefab is a game object. Alright. So there's our instantiated game object, our spinning coin. So we need to, what we're going to do to make our positioning a little easier is we're going to assign spinning coin transform. We're going to set its parent to this transform's parent so that we are so that we can position relative to that. And then we're going to take the spinning coin transform's local position. Local position. And we're going to set it equal to a new vector, 2. And we're going to pass in the original. Original position dot x and original position dot y plus 1, because we wanted to actually instantiate one unit higher than the block. And then finally we're going to call our coroutine move coin, and we're going to pass in our spinning coin game object as the coin that we want to move. Okay. And this present coin method is going to be called from our bounce script after we change the sprite. So change Just present coin. Okay. That's going to call that. And now we need to work on our move coin coroutine. So this is going to be much like our bounce coroutine in that we're going to have two while loops. Okay. While true. Okay, the first loop is going to transform, set our local position equal to a new vector 2, and it's going to get coin.transform dot local position dot x, because we're actually not moving in the x direction, only in the y, and then we're going to do coin.transform dot local position dot y, plus the coin move speed times time dot delta time. Okay, so this is going to change our transform's local position by incrementing our current y position by the coin move speed times time dot delta time. And then what we need to do next is we need to check if it's reached our height, right? So we do if coin dot transform dot local position dot y is greater than or equal to original position dot y plus coin move height. Okay, so if it's at every iteration, the coin is going to move up a little more, and it's also going to check to see if the coin has already exceeded the coin move height that we've set, and we get that by adding it to the original y position. Okay, and we should probably add one to this because we've added one to our original position when we instantiated it. So we need to add one to the end of coin move height because we're one higher than our original position. So if we want to actually have the move height that we've specified and not one less than that, then we need to add the one that we added in the original position when we instantiated the coin up here. Okay, so we'll add one to that. And if that's true, like if it's greater than that position, then we're going to go ahead and break out of the while loop and continue executing our code here in the next while loop. Actually, before we do that, we need to, again, yield return null. And just so that we don't forget it in this one, let's go ahead and start the yield return null. All right, so that's already at the end of our line. We don't need to worry about it. Okay, so now for going back down, we're going to do the same thing. Coin.transform dot local position. It's a new vector 2. Coin.transform dot local position dot x. Coin.transform dot local position dot y minus coin move speed times time dot delta time. Okay. All right. So basically the same thing as our other while loop, but this one decrements instead of increments. And so here we need to check if coin dot transform dot local position dot y is less than or equal to original position dot y plus the coin fall distance plus 1, again, because we instantiated a coin one higher than the original position. If that's true, then we want to destroy the coin game object. And we want to break out of our loop. Okay. So that should take care of the coin instantiating and destroying using the variables that we've defined here. So the coin is going to move up at a speed of 8. It's going to get 3 units higher than where it started. Then it's going to fall 2 units. Then it's going to get destroyed. And that all happens when the bounce coroutine starts, the present coin method is called. The present coin method instantiates the coin prefab. Then we set the parent of the coin equal to the parent of this transform. Then we set the local position to 1 higher than the block that the coin is in. And then we start our move coin coroutine, which moves our coin up and back down and then destroys it. Okay, so all of this should work. We're gonna go ahead and try that out. Open up Unity, click play. And let's wait for our enemy. All right, now we're gonna bounce at our coin. And there's our coin, 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 and coin. All right, everything's working. One thing that I do want to talk about real quick is this ground, because we used a prefab. So if you want to make it longer, the one thing you're going to have to do here, let's go into our scene, and I'm going to zoom out a little bit. Okay, our ground, which is this right here, this has a collider on it. So if we want to add ground to this, okay, we can go into our prefabs, and we can just go in here, drag this right at the end, right, and add to it. Well, one thing you need to know is the best way to position this is, you see how we have an x of 55.45 and a y of 0.15? Well, we already know that the ground needs to be positioned at 0 on y, and that aligns it in the y direction. And to align it to the end of this, if you try to get it as close as possible, you can usually round up and go with like 55.5. Or actually, no, we don't want halves. We have holes. So 55 would actually put this in a perfect spot. Okay, so there, your ground is longer. And now what you can do is take your right bounds, and that's right here. Okay, you just kind of drag that over here. Alright, so we've got our right bounds, and we need to make sure it's all the way at the edge, so it's 66.08. We'll just put it at 66. And now it's good, alright? So now, if you look at our ground again, this ground has no collider. This ground has a collider. So, we don't need to assign another collider to this ground. All we need to do is we need to actually just edit this collider, and, drag it out further, okay? You can drag it all the way to the end. And it looks like the end is gonna be somewhere around 66 with 32.5 being the center, the offset, okay? So now we've just made this longer, all right? So, and that's how easy it is. So we can just go back in and play. And now if we jump over our door, okay, we have more more ground to walk on. All right. Okay, so we've got that. We've covered this. There was one more thing I was going to. Okay, so if you want to add a hole to the platform here, right? So as everybody knows, any Mario game you play, you have just holes that you fall into and you die. This doesn't have any of that. So what you would do here is you would do the same thing. Let's see here. Let's take this right bounds, and we're going to move it a little further to the right. And then we're gonna drag out another ground prefab. We'll put this, let's put it right here. Okay, let's zoom in a little bit. All right, it's pretty close. So it looks like it's gonna be at 66 and 0. Okay. And that'll put it right beside it, but we want a hole. So let's see here. So 67, we'll move it 1, and 68. Let's do 69. Okay, that's a pretty deep, pretty good sized hole. So then we also need to line our right bounds back up. So let's go ahead and move that, and it looks like we're going to be at 80. All right. So here we have our hole. This doesn't have a collider, okay? So in order to add a collider to this, you would just go to Add Component and do Box Collider 2D. And you see how it's a little square, and that's because it's just doing the collider for this one square, because like I said before, this is an empty, just like every other one of these. These are all empties. So you would just go Edit Collider, and you would drag it up. And you see how the Y values are changing? So this would be actually y equals 2, and the offset would be 0.5. Okay, and then you also want to drag it out, and looks like it's going to be 11 size and 5 for the offset. All right, so now we've got a collider here, and we've got a collider here. This is our other ground. Okay. All right. So now we should be able to jump from here to here, and everything should be good. Let's try that out. Okay. Awesome. So right now, if we just like fall into this hole, nothing really happens, right? So one way that you could actually solve this is to create a class and an empty with a collider. So I'll give you guys a quick example. So we'll create an empty and we'll call it hole. And we'll add a collider. Right, so now we have our collider, and we need to actually move this. And we're going to edit our collider to kind of just drag it out a little bit. All right, we're going to create it as a trigger, and we're just going to move it down to here. No, let's go here. This way we can't see the player. The screen changes. All right, so we got it to collider and we got a trigger. All right, so now we need a script. So let's create a new script, C sharp. I'm gonna call this just call it hole. All right, so we want to edit this. Let's double click on it, and it's completely empty. So what we'll do here is we'll just get rid of this. And remember, I said the colliders that have triggers. Receive trigger events when someone collides with them, right? So what we'll do is let's see here, on trigger enter, this is actually void, on trigger enter 2D, right? And we're going to get a collider object. I'm going to call other again because it's the other collider, just an easy reference. We're going to check and make sure that it's the player. If other.collider, or sorry, if other.tag equals player, all right, so if the collider's tag is the player, then we want to application.loadLevel game over. All right, so that's pretty much it. That's all the code you're going to need to make that kill the player, right? Because we haven't really added anything like lives and other things, we're basically going to directly to the game over screen. We're going to the game over screen, and then we have to start the game all over again. We haven't given any lives, we haven't given any coins, They don't keep track of scores. So these are all things that you could implement. So here, the game over. So now if we play this, and actually I don't like this whole script right here. We need to actually move this to the scripts. And, oops. Got a problem here. In our whole script. Or not. Unity thinks there is. But there isn't. Why is it telling us we have an error? Here we are, and let's jump into our hole. And look, we can stand on it. That's not supposed to happen. How are we walking on this hole? Our script actually has a problem with the onTrigger enter 2D event that we've just created. And, you know, apparently Unity will still run even with this error present. But the problem actually is, and if you'll look, it'll tell you, the message parameter has to be of type collider2D. And the message is what the event is sending us, which is the type of object we're getting. And look at what we have here. We have collider instead of collider2D. So we need to just change that to collider2D, and it should fix all our problems. All right? So let's go ahead and give that a shot. And coins, jump over the castle, get to the end, following the hole, and we didn't die. Why? Oh, because you know what? We're not supposed to ignore collisions. What am I thinking? We actually are going to have to add this to the default layer so that the player does collide with it. Because we actually need that collision to register. Let's do this again. Jump over the castle. And this time we're just going to jump directly into the hole. Oh, and look, we died. This is the game over screen, by the way. In case you guys didn't know, it's blank. But yeah, it's the game over screen. So, yeah, so this is like one of the many things that you can actually do to add stuff to the game. You can add holes. And it's just that easy to create a hole and have it register as a trigger for a collision, and then do something because of that, like register a game over. You could also very easily keep track of coins, and if you reach 100 coins, you set yourself an extra life, and then you can check to see if you know how many lives you have before you trigger the game over screen. You can check. Let's say you start out with 5 lives. Every time you signal the game over screen, you could instead call the level scene, and that could get complicated because you have to actually store your variables so that they don't get deleted. And there are plenty of ways to do that, and I'd be willing to give you guys some pointers on where to get started on research and trying to figure that out. There are so many things that you can do to add to this game. If you can't think of anything, or if you just completely run out of ideas, just let me know. I'm always happy to help. This is it. This is the end of the tutorial, the end of the series, and I hope you guys enjoyed it. Until next time, I'll see you guys soon.